It's that time of the year where Adobe updates Lightroom Classic. We now have the new Lightroom Classic 2025 or version 14 of Lightroom Classic. Let's jump in right now and have a look at the most important new features. All right, let's launch Lightroom Classic. First time you launch it, it will want to upgrade your catalog. So let's just go ahead and do that. Now it's upgrading the catalog to work with this version of Lightroom Classic. Now let's just look at the catalog settings. And if we go under general, we can actually go to the catalog and we'll see these are the catalogs here. So the one I'm saving is under aerial photos. And as we can see here, there's all the old ones and this one has been updated. So it shows the version number of it there. Now the nice thing is we can delete the old ones, but we can also rename this into a more useful name, which is much easier to do now. Choose File, Rename Catalog. And now we're just going to change this to 2025. And let's rename the parent folder too. Click on Rename. It's successfully renamed. We can see that. There it is, the 2025. And then once you've made sure that everything is working correctly, then you can safely just go ahead and you can delete those old catalogs. So when we update our Lightroom catalog, it actually creates a backup automatically of the old one right there. So if you have any problems, you can unzip that and then launch from that one. Now I've had a lot of people tell me when they go to open the images in Photoshop, it's loading into Photoshop beta instead of the regular Photoshop. So this is how we change that. If we choose the preferences, you'll see external editing, and under the version, you can change it from beta to Photoshop 2025. And now it should work. If it still doesn't work, make sure you launch Photoshop 2025 first, and then just right click and then choose edit in Photoshop, and it should open in the correct version. And if you're getting any value out of this video, hit that subscribe button, turn on notifications, you won't miss any of my videos. So Generative Remove has got some updates. Let's have a look here. Maybe we can get rid of some of these distractions. So if we go under there, we have the option to use Generative AI, which is actually using Adobe Firefly. And you want to be working on smaller areas. You don't want to be working on areas larger than 1K, which would be 124 pixels square, because then we can have resolution issues. So those are larger areas. It's not going to work as well as it will for smaller areas. And then we have another option here is to detect objects. So let's turn the detect objects on. All right, so one of the ways we can select is to just loop select now. So say we go around this dumpster here and we do just a quick selection. Notice it will detect it, and it will make the selection there. Now the cool thing is we can also add to that selection. So if I want to include maybe this stuff over here, we can just keep painting and that will also add that to our selection. Let's also include the shadow because it won't make sense to have that there. And at this point, we're just gonna hit remove. Well, let's see how good a job it does on here. And I'm gonna say that's pretty impressive. We get three variations, so we can hit the second variation and then the third variation. I think I like the second variation where it looks like the tree there is on the other side of the road. All right, let's look at another option we have, and that's to scribble select. So we don't have to do good selections, just scribble and say, hey, I want to select the dumpster. Notice it selects it, and then we can hit remove once again. And if we go to this variation, definitely looking the best. So the other thing is, even though we've already removed from these areas, we can remove other objects such as here. So say we want to clean all this stuff up and then we can just hit remove. And I'm thinking the third variation works the best there. Here's our before and here's our after. As long as we keep these constrained to smaller areas, we're not really going to have any resolution issues. We could print this and it would look just fine. So another new feature is an update to the tethering for the Nikon cameras. So recently I showed you the new one for Sony, where Adobe built their own API and it just works really good. It's really fast. If you unplug the camera, you can plug it back in without restarting. All those features are now in the Nikon tethering. I don't have a Nikon camera to demonstrate that, but I'll link to the Sony one. Works exactly the same. Now, another thing that's interesting is if we choose to file export content credentials. So if we were to choose a format, say like a JPEG, we have the ability to add these. So we can attach it to the file. So this means that we can put our information with the photograph and we can attach it to the file, meaning it will travel with the photo. Or we could publish it to the content credentials cloud where it will use matching to find that, or we can do it to both. So let me just show you some of the things we can set up in here. So we can set up the producer, which is your name, and we can connect different social media accounts, and it will also show the edits and activity if you choose to show that. If we hit the manage, it goes in, and here we have the ability where we can connect with different social media accounts. Now I'm hoping for Facebook and YouTube to be added on here, but we've definitely got that. And by the way, if you're creating NFTs, we have the ability to put our Web3 wallets in here as well, which means that when people see those photos, they're going to be able to find out more about you. And so if we turn these on now, when we export, those are going to travel with the file. And yes, if people really want to steal your images, they're going to anyway, they're going to strip this out, or they could just take a screen capture. But this just makes it easy for people to identify you and find the creator of a picture. If they see it online, maybe they want to license it or find out more information. And if we look under here, there's 7 new adaptive presets have been added. And the adaptive presets, what they do is they look at the photograph. So like maybe it's a sky replacement. They'll detect the sky individually on each photo. It's just essentially using the AI masks. Okay, so say we'll do this one I shot of Brooke. This is straight out of camera here. And maybe we're going to look at some of the portrait adaptive ones. Let's choose an enhanced portrait. So if I click on there, what it's going to do is it's going to apply the AI filters to this photograph. And if we look into the filters, you can see what's been done. Looks like the face has been softened and some other thing. And it looks like a lens blur has also been applied. So all of those are part of that adaptive preset right there. And so there's 7 new ones. All right, so let's have a look at the noise reduction. If we look at a photograph like this one, notice there's a lot of noise in there. This has shot at a high ISO, develop module. And then we go into the detail. You see we have the ability here to apply the denoise. And if we look in this window here, we can see this is also working with the enhanced version. So this works pretty much like it did before. This time it's out of preview, so it's not early access anymore. It's a full-fledged feature. So we're going to hit enhance. And then just like it did before, this is going to create a new image. And it's going to do that noise reduction. So if we have a look at this compared to the before, after, it's really quite incredible. Now there's a newer version of this inside of Camera Raw. Check out my other video where it will actually apply it to the original file instead of creating a new file. Now this one also has support for more types of cameras, more sorts of RAW files, including the Pro RAW and iPhones as well as Google Pixels. So that AI noise reduction is no longer in beta, it's now in the regular version of Lightroom Classic. And once again, it only works on certain types of RAW files. So this is a merged HDR image, it shows more dynamic range, meaning you can see details in the shadows, you can see details in the highlights. Now, if you have an HDR-enabled monitor, you can really see this. In fact, sometimes when you're on your, maybe your iPhone, you can see an HDR image and it just really pops. It looks beautiful. And you're probably used to seeing that maybe on your TVs now. So if we turn on the HDR, which we just click here, and also there's a shortcut. If you hit the Shift H key, that can pop us into HDR. Because we're not filming this in HDR, you really can't see the extra detail that I could see on my monitor. And if you look into the histogram, you can see the amount that would not be seen. All this information would be lost on a standard dynamic range image. Now, I'm showing you this for a reason, because there's another feature that we're going to talk about. Now, the thing is, if I hit Visualize HDR, you can see the areas that are being lost. If I was to display this on an HDR display, you would see all this detail. Now, if you don't have an HDR display, we can go under here and preview for SDR and notice that you probably see more detail right now on the video. But this detail here was very, very vibrant on an HDR display. So we can create a tone map for it which is going to look good on a non-HDR. And then when we're viewing it on an HDR, you're going to see this. So it's creating two versions of this. And if we choose File Export, and then we choose an image format like a JPEG XL that supports this, Adobe has a new feature called Gain Map. And this Gain Map actually writes both of them into a file. So when a person is looking at these pictures, it will display a different image based on whether you have an HDR display or you don't have an HDR display. And this is a nice way for us to get our HDR content out there for early adopters while not ruining the experience for people with legacy hardware. So they're still going to be able to view your photo as there on a non-HDR. On an HDR, they're going to see that. Now, if you have an HDR display, you're still not going to see this detail because this video is not HDR. And speaking of HDR, so if you set up a secondary display, which generally speaking is going to be shown on the second monitor, this can now have HDR previews in the thumbnails as well as when we're in the loop view. This can also show HDR on the second display now. That's a brand new feature. So those are the new features in Lightroom Classic. Now be aware that normally Lightroom Classic and Adobe Camera Raw have identical feature set. In this case, there's a little bit of divergence. There's some newer features in Camera Raw right now that are not in Lightroom. I've made a video, check it out right there. And drop a comment and let me know your favorite new features inside of Lightroom Classic. And if you're new, welcome to the cafe. Hit the subscribe button, turn on notifications. You won't miss any of my tutorials. And until next time, I'll see you at the cafe.